BBOR, Black Box Online Radio, coming to you from West Virginia. The first thing, just to drop a bit of news, thank you to anybody who has checked out our Zodiac Killer book discussion on Zodiac Unmasked by Robert Graysmith. And if you're listening to this in the future, we have a Zodiac Killer book discussion on Robert Graysmith's Zodiac Unmasked, so I would invite you to listen to that. And moving on to today's topic, this is one that's actually somewhat of a more saddening case. We're going to be discussing the life and times, as well as the suicide of August Ames. August Ames was born Mercedes Gabrowski in 1994, and she passed away on the 5th of December in 2017. While this happened a couple years ago, I only recently learned about everything that had went down. I mean, August Ames was an adult film actress. She was a porn star, for lack of a better term. I had never seen any of her videos before. I'm not like a complete stranger to porn, but I had only found out about her until recently. She received a lot of attention, press, scrutiny, criticism for a particular tweet that she had issued. And we're just going to read that off right now. "Whichever lady performer is replacing me tomorrow for Erotica X News, you're shooting with a guy who has shot gay porn, just to let you know. BS is all I can say. Do agents really not care about who they're representing? Hashtag LA Direct. I do my homework for my body." And after issuing that tweet, August Ames was sent with a barrage of people on Twitter, bullying her, saying demeaning comments, telling her that she needs to take cyanide, talking her into suicide. And that's what happened, as we said, on the 5th of December 2017. August Ames committed suicide by asphyxiation, hanging herself, more or less, if we want to say that more bluntly. What do we make of this situation? Once you actually, though, begin to peel away some of the layers, because, you know, life isn't black and white, but once you actually get between the layers and you can actually hear what she's talking about, the sad thing is, I don't think that she actually said anything super outrageous. You know, I had this professor once, and he was one of those types who's kind of like a motor mouth who just rambles on and on and on and on. And he just did drop one sentence one time when he said, "Sometimes it's not only the conclusions that you reach, it's the manner that you use to reach the conclusion to begin with." And I think that this is a perfect example of that, because what she was talking about is not being anti-gay or homophobic, talking about the porn industry. And she was refusing to work with someone who had done either gay on straight porn or bisexual porn, meaning someone who works with both men and women. In some sources, you'll hear her hear that she refused a guy who was straight but did gay on straight porn. In other sources, they say it's bisexual porn. I mean, you can kind of get the idea. But the thing is that they're saying about it, and that she was saying about it, is there is a higher risk for HIV transmission. That's kind of the famous thing that's put around. But you actually listen to what August Ames was talking about. What she is saying is, in the porn industry, they do frequent medical checks, frequent STI checks, to make sure that, you know, someone doesn't have an infection. But there was something that was going on in the gay porn industry where, if condoms were present or used, they would forego the STI checks. They would not check if someone had a sexually transmitted infection. And she's like, that is something that is an absolute no-go. And that's why she was speaking out against that. So when you actually read some things like that, I mean, it's presented in somewhat of an outrageous way in this tweet, but I don't think she actually said anything outrageous that, hey, they have different standards when they're shooting these different types of videos, and I don't feel comfortable working with someone who didn't recently have this STI check or something like that. Because bear in mind, especially when you're talking about something like HIV, even like 6 months or something, I only did an HIV test once, and they told me if you have had any risky behavior within 6 months, it may not come up. So, I mean, this would be the biggest thing to be concerned about. But like, after the suicide of August Ames, I really saw that a lot of people were just trying to use this situation for their political agenda. And it's left, right, coming at it from all angles. People were trying to use the death of this person as a way to justify their political platform. And some of the articles were coming out one day or 2 days after the death of August Ames. And I just was like, how poor taste can you be? How ridiculous, insensitive, and thoughtless can you be? Like, somebody has just died, and you're just trying to make a cheap political point. And it's on all sides of the spectrum. Not only right, not only left, all people, like, once you actually go through some of the material, a lot of people began speaking out about the situation and trying to come to the defense of August Ames, just saying that this situation should not have happened. And that one of them was the very famous adult entertainer, Jenna Jameson. And she issued a series of tweets coming to the defense of August Ames. One of them was, shame on you. You need to reevaluate your life. You are becoming a lynch mob. When anyone says something you don't like, I have been on the other end of it and received death threats from it. Stop this shit now. And I think that, I mean, she issued many tweets, but I think that one really captivated and just captured a lot of what, I mean, the more of a balanced perspective on the subject, if you will, because what they're sort of just saying is people are so busy being outrageous. And they're so busy shouting. Do they even know what they're yelling about? But in terms of outrageousness, when we said, though, about like the manner in which somebody presents their material, I mean, this is going to sound a little bit cheesy, but Dr. Phil has this thing called outrageous overshadowing, when sometimes someone's outrageous behavior overshadows a greater problem. And I really began to just think about that when I was reading off these words that we read from August Ames. It's like people are trying to use that as something that they can blow out of proportion to not focus on the real issue that was going on, like that perhaps, you know, somebody or perhaps the entire gay porn industry had this giant loophole in their STI checking that was being neglected. And she's like, hey, I don't agree with the way that they are doing these things out of health concerns. And that's not a gay or straight thing. That's talking about, hey, there's this problem in the way that they're conducting their STI screenings. Like, there's a loophole in it. There's a problem with it. Once again, that's not about anybody's humanity. Now, I was listening to the Howard Stern show once, and he was interviewing someone. I don't know her name, but she was the porn star who did the Sarah Palin porno. I had found out about her because of that Howard Stern interview. That's the only time that I have seen her. But they were talking about the concept of just instituting protection in the porn industry. By protection, I mean condoms. Like, they were saying that in the Netherlands, all pornography had to be shot with condoms, with protection of that nature. And he is asking her, what do you think about that? Should the United States of America do things like that? And she said, yes, if it's going to reduce the risk of disease, all porn should be shot with condoms. During a lot of the old Sasha Gray interviews that you could find, you could hear her frequently talking about STIs. And Sasha Gray said very clearly that she had almost every single sexually transmitted disease. And the way that she would explain it is, in the porn industry, you would get an STI check every 25 days. And, I mean, still, though, within 25 days, it was very easy to contract an infection. Because one of the things that's heavily neglected when talking about porn is many adult entertainers, well, not many, nearly all of them, also have a personal life. I mean, a lot of them are involved with relationships. They're also seeing other people. They're like having sex with people off the set, which they have every right to do. I mean, that's one of the more normal things about adulthood. And then, you know, like other things can be passed around and the STIs can spread. And even within the 25-day period, people can still like obtain a sexually transmitted infection, and then that can spread throughout the porn industry. So, I mean, I really don't think it's the craziest thing in the world to use condoms during all pornographic shoots. I mean, I really think a lot of people in terms of people who watch porn would be very much opposed to that. I mean, just from talking to people I know, but I think you got to put the health of human beings, like, that has to be paramount. When it comes to the concept of STI checking, really there is something that has to be reinforced as well, that just because people are getting frequent STI examinations, it doesn't mean that they aren't going to get it. Like, I was talking to someone who was a former friend, we should say, and he's talking about how he went to a country for sex tourism. And he's like, oh, yeah, I went with my buddy Mike, and he never uses condoms when he's with sex workers. And I'm like, what are you talking about? I mean, have you heard of HIV? He's like, no, no, it's fine. The girls have these health cards. They get, like, frequent medical checks, and then if they, you know, get an infection or they get AIDS, then they can't work anymore. I was like, what are you saying? Just because they have a health check card, that's not magical. It's not a magic wand. I mean, like, look what we said about the porn industry. Within a 25-day period, many STIs can take form in the body, and it can be transmitted only one time. So, I mean, that's just a ridiculous thing to think that frequent STI checks would eliminate disease. But the thing August Ames was talking about was very simple. Just that she was opposed to the way that the gay porn industry was screening for infections. And she's like, they have a major problem. I do have to confess, though, she did phrase this in a way that I do not agree with. Do I think that she should have been cyberbullied to the point of committing suicide? No, absolutely not. And the people that did that to her were wrong. After the death of August Ames, there was also, well, I mean, throughout the medical examination process, they found that she had Zoloft and Xanax in her system, and she also had a family history of bipolar disorder. So, I mean, it seemed like she had somewhat of a fragile mental state to begin with, and when she received the full frontal of this cyberbullying, that pushed her over the edge. It's a very tragic situation that someone would have to go out like this. I mean, it's tragic on all fronts. And in all reality, you can just see that, I mean, this type of cyberbullying is just ridiculous. And that's one of the few times when I would just have to say, Jenna Jameson was spot on when she said, stop this shit now. But there is a book that is out on this called The End of August, written by an individual named John Ronson. Sometimes it's referred to as a book and sometimes it's referred to as a podcast because it's a series that was released on Audible. You might remember John Ronson as the guy who did the TED Talk Strange Answers to the Psychopath Test, and everybody was thinking, is that really his name? Or is it Ron Johnson? A lot of people referring to him as that, but his name is John Ronson, and he put out the book The End of August. I would love to read that. I'm going to see if I can just get it on Amazon and put it on Kindle. But the big thing that we should always be aware of in this particular situation is that when people want to respond to things, they often do not anticipate the consequences. Now, sometimes when I come home late at night, I don't like to watch movies. I don't like to watch anything that's, you know, super long. I just want to come home, you know, you're feeling tired, you just put on some audio. And I just put on, like, whatever video that came up in the suggested playlist. And it turned out that it was, like, it was a porn star interview. It wasn't with August Ames, it was with the porn star Nikki Benz. So, you know, I just, instead of going to sleep, I just watched a couple of those things. And because I had been watching some porn star interviews, it only took a matter of time for the YouTube algorithm to introduce me to the channel Ask an Escort. And I started watching that one and went down a big rabbit hole with that last night, actually just, you know, one video after another. It's hosted by someone named Sierra Pine, and while she's talking about escorting versus the porn industry, she did get onto a question, and this is very relevant. This isn't just going off on some weird tangent, but she was talking about why sex workers refuse certain clients. And what she said was, sometimes you have to look at the intention that is behind a person's behavior. And I mean, like, I don't know if that really just struck me as a very profound statement, but she said a lot of things in that video that I actually disagreed with when it came to the concept of refusing people. But just that one sentence just really stood out. And like, when you actually think about what August Ames was saying right here, that, you know, it's like, you have to look at the intention behind a person's behavior. I mean, the intention that she's saying, she's not saying that gay people are not human or that they don't deserve to exist or something like that, or no one should be with them. The actual idea that she was trying to express is that there are problems with the way that gay porn is screening its participants. And this could have, you know, health consequences for a lot of people, particularly through the transmission of HIV. I don't believe that that's an outrageous statement. I mean, if they're saying that, oh, certain people don't have to get STI checks if they don't have condoms. I mean, if they have condoms present. So, I mean, even if it turned out that that was completely false or something like that, then, and like that wasn't even true, the fact that she believed that that was true, which I believe, but the fact is that she didn't make an outrageous claim. You know, just if you were to go on that statement, that is not something that is even dehumanizing. But it almost feels that she did portray her message in somewhat of an outrageous stance. Some of the points that they were discussing in that video about, you know, why you would refuse certain people. One of the challenges was, what would you say to a woman who had been sexually assaulted by her grandfather and said that she did not want to work with older men? Like, that was like one of the challenge questions that was put out. And I was like, well, that's when you really get into some intense gray area, because, I mean, that is ageism. It absolutely is. Does a person have the right to say that in the escorting business or in the porn industry? I'm not 100% sure, because I don't really know if the civil rights era took into account escorting in the porn industry when they were drafting the laws, and these things might be somewhat outside of the parameters. But like, because you're asking somebody to have sex with a person, do they have the right to refuse any person they want for any reason? I mean, you would think yes, but at the same time, is that just like blatant discrimination in that example? You're saying, I'm not 100% sure, and that can be sort of a challenge question that we could explore today. But in terms of challenges, I would much rather hear, what do you think about the material that we've been discussing about August Ames, rather, where, like, do you believe that her claim was something that was unjustified, ungrounded, and something that was out of line? Or do you believe that she actually was in the right? And I would really hope that we can really focus on her intentions and her material. And perhaps in the future, if I do get a copy of The End of August by John Ronson, we can have some bigger discussions about that. We have a couple books in the work right now. Like I said, I always read 3 or 4 books at the same time. But, and we are going to continue onward with our discussions on Zodiac Unmasked. But this is some material that we haven't really talked about too much on the channel. We did an upload once on War Machine, the assault on Christy Mack, but that wasn't so much talking about like what is going on in the porn industry. And even if you just have some more questions or some things that you would like discussed on the channel in relation to some of the issues that go on with the porn industry escorting, I'm definitely not an insider to something like that. I would definitely have to approach that as someone who is an outsider, who is just reading the books and watching the documentaries and reading the news articles. And at this time, I would like to thank abcnews.australia, medium.com. I read an article from The Federalist that I thought was just in very poor taste. That was one of the articles that I said where they're just blatantly trying to justify a political platform, but I would cite them because that's one of the articles that I read as well. Medium.com is one. I use them from time to time because they talk about interesting things, but I really do not like their presentation the most. And I'd like to thank Fox News from Atlanta. That's not the regular Fox News channel, but Fox News did do a big article about this as well. But I didn't even read that one because I felt that they were probably going to come at it from a slant. But I would like to thank Fox from Atlanta. All right, well, what do you think about this case here? What do you think about the death of August Ames? And if you have anything to say at all about the porn industry, cyberbullying, as well as the response to some of the challenge questions that we put out, I would love to hear from you. If you like this upload, you can hit the like button. And if you haven't subscribed yet, you're welcome to do so. But most importantly, please drop a comment below. And until next time.